This morning, what I want to do is, and I appreciate that last song, Craig, that you chose and that the band led us in, a little bit of a series or a message to kind of tie in from what Pastor Bartley shared with us out of the book of Job on adversity, which was a fabulous, fabulous series to think through just how to handle the difficulties of life that come to us. To do that and to kind of lead into from that series and to prepare our hearts for Easter. So that's what we're going to take a look at this morning. This past week, I went to the funeral of a dear aunt of mine. Her name was Aunt Edith, and she passed away. She would have been 92 early in April. Loved the Lord, had walked with the Lord all of her life, and it was great to be a part of celebrating her life and also reflecting back upon the good news that's in Christ and the hope that's in Christ. And we sang a lot of old hymns. We don't sing a whole lot of hymns here. And I like the newer music, but I was raised on the hymns. And we sang six old hymns, every single verse of them, with the old hymn books. How many of you remember old hymn books? You got to turn to this number, turn to that number, and you got to know how to work it. And I was amazed. It's been years since I've sung some of these hymns. I knew every single word of them by heart. Like, Great is Thy Faithfulness, My Jesus, I Love Thee, a whole bunch of other ones that some of you older ones may remember. And I was just able to sing them. I even remember the parts. I could even sing some of the parts, too. It was kind of neat to be a part of it. And we sang about, there were some talks about pearly gates, and we sang hymns about mansions. Cool. Wouldn't that be great? We're looking forward to our mansions one day and being in glory and getting mansions, right? The only problem is that's not what Jesus was talking about. And the passage we're going to take a look at actually talks about mansions. It has been translated as mansions. But we're actually going to see that Jesus has something far greater, far better than a mansion to look forward to in his presence. He has something much more grand than a manor house in heaven. And we so quickly import materialistic perspectives into our understanding of God and of the spiritual life. And we often prefer the blessings of prosperity. We want it in this life and we want it in the next life. But we miss out sometimes on what really God has to say to us, which is something infinitely greater and much more rewarding and much more fulfilling. And as we looked at this last series, we know that life is difficult, right? We saw that, we heard that, we were reminded of that in the story of Job. Life can be full of difficulties and troubles. We want the good life, but it so often proves to be elusive to us, and we end up experiencing hardships, and we struggle with stress and with distress. We just think back again to Job's story. Problems can arise for all kinds of different reasons. Sometimes we make bad choices, right? And we bring the evil upon ourselves. It's our fault. Sometimes other people make choices and it affects us. We're caught up in their sin. Sometimes just because we live in a fallen, broken world, we can be distressed because things don't go the way we had hoped. And sometimes, as we saw in Job's story, that there's some things going on, a spiritual battle behind the scenes that we may not even be aware of. God is working out his plans. We have to just sometimes hold on for dear life. At these times, we can feel lost. We can sometimes feel abandoned by God, victims of circumstances, and feel like caving in. Where can we? What can we do, and where can we turn? Well, this morning, Jesus has some words of encouragement for us, some words of comfort, some words to support us in those difficult times, some hope for us today. And we've been singing about that even as we've been worshiping the Lord. And today, Jesus is going to acknowledge our distress. He's going to acknowledge the problems of life. He's going to give us a directive to obey. He's going to reveal our ultimate destination. And then he's going to provide the directions to help us get to his destination safely. And so if you have your Bibles, I really encourage you to turn with me to actually a very beloved passage of Scripture, John chapter 14. John 14. And this is an important passage. Jesus is in the just hours before he's going to be betrayed and taken off and sentenced to die. And he is speaking with his beloved followers, his little crew, motley crew of followers, and he's sharing with them some last ideas, some last words, and those last words are critically important. And John records it for us in the upper room from John chapter 13 through John chapter 17. So this is right in the midst of that. And in here, we're going to find what causes some distress. And you're going to see what's going on in the disciples' lives and see ourselves in this as well. Follow along as I read these first seven verses. That's what we're going to take a look at this morning. John 14, 1 through 7. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. Some translations have mansions, has many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you, I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. What causes stress? What causes distress? And what can we do about it? And Jesus' first words to us is this: determine your response to distress. Determine ahead of time. Determine your response to distress. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trouble, hardship, problems, difficulties, they are inevitable. If you've lived any time on this earth, you know hard times are going to come. Life rarely goes according to plan, and we all face these difficulties. I am not a golf player, but I understand that life is very much like the game of golf. You hit the ball as best you can and hope it goes where you want it to go, and sometimes it does land on the fairway, and sometimes it actually ends up on the green, but most often it's in the rough, or it's behind some obstacle, or in a sand trap, or a water hazard, or somewhere where you're going to have to play it wherever it lies. And that is what so much of life is like. You've got to play it where you find it. And sometimes we find ourselves struggling over finances and distressed over that. There's never enough. Things keep breaking. Things get lost. Things need maintenance. Life is expensive in the GTA. Have you noticed? There's always never enough to go around. We struggle with our finances. We may have social, political, cultural, moral shifts that are going on in our world that unsettles us and cause us some distress. Work or school demands make us feel like we can never get ahead. We may be facing some relational stress at home, at work, at school, in our relationships, in our marriages, maybe even at church. These things can drag us down and sap our energies. And often we can find ourselves saying, I didn't sign up for this. This is a lot more difficult than I had anticipated. You're not alone. We all feel that at times, and you may be feeling that even this morning. Whatever's going on in your life, you may feel that you're going through a very, very difficult time. That's the same situation the disciples were as Jesus gives them these words. They had been just blasted, really, with a whole bunch of news that was just very, very discouraging and disheartening for them. They had left everything to follow Jesus. All their hopes and dreams were tied up in him. They believed him to be God's promised Messiah, the answer to everything that they were looking for in life. And then suddenly things started to go sideways. The religious establishment turned against Jesus. He began to speak of leaving them, of his impending death, that one of them would betray him, that Peter, was going to deny him three times, that Satan was plotting against them, and that they would soon all be scattered. And suddenly their whole world began to crumble all around them. What in the world is going on? I didn't sign up for this. We can relate to that, because often things happen to us that leaves us with this feeling of everything is crumbling all around us. Here's what I want you to see. Jesus knows and Jesus cares. He's the one who spoke these words to their troubled hearts. He was right there with them. He knew that they were going to get both barrels, so to speak, with all of this news. It was going to be a very, very difficult struggle. And he knew that they were troubled. In fact, he was too. In the chapters just preceding to this, the same word, being troubled, was used of Jesus. He was troubled when he was at Lazarus' tomb with death and how people were responding to that and just the whole sadness that goes on in the human race because we are mortal. He was troubled by the fact that he was going to die. His death was looming on the horizon. And he was troubled by the fact that one of his followers was going to betray him. The same language is used. Jesus has entered into our distress. Jesus has come to be where we are. That's why, one of the many reasons why he came into this world. He understands what it's like to have life collapsing all around us and for us to be in distress. He is with us in our distress. He's not aloof or indifferent. And he knows and he cares, and so he tells us what to do, and he actually models it for us to determine our response to distress. Do not let your hearts be troubled. This is actually in the form of a command. Now, he's not rebuking them or getting mad at them. He's just saying you need to determine ahead of time what your response is going to be to the fact that life is difficult, that there are hardships. It's a command. The sense is you're distressed, but stop letting your heart be troubled. And the little word your is actually plural. He has switched over from talking to Peter individually to addressing all of them together. Don't let your hearts together. You're in this together, men and women and all of us together. We're in this together. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Don't sit back passively. Do something proactively. Help one another. And we all have a choice as to how we're going to respond to distressing circumstances. We know they're going to come. What are we going to do? We can get knocked over by life's breakers, or we can fight to stay on our feet despite the breakers that are battling us. And Jesus is telling those who are distressed, don't give up. I'm with you in this. Keep going. We'll get going where? Where can we find some hope in distressing circumstances? Well, Jesus goes on to say, find hope through faith. This is the key to the Christian life, is faith, trusting. You believe in God, believe also in me, Jesus said. This is the centrality, the importance of faith in the Christian life. Now, I actually believe that everybody is a person of faith, whether you're a believer in Jesus or not. Everybody exercises faith. The issue is who or what are people trusting? They can be trusting in themselves. They can be trusting in technology. They're trusting in science, in human ingenuity. You could be trusting in a different religion. You could be trusting in a philosophy of life. Everybody trusts in some aspect of life. The issue is who or what are you trusting, and is that, in fact, trustworthy? Sometimes we find ourselves trusting in the wrong things and the problems of life. The difficulties get too big for us, and we want to give up and give way. However, we don't need to so easily give up. And Jesus' directive here is, you believe in God, believe also in me. It's actually a very interesting text when Jesus says this, believe, you believe in God, believe also in me. There's a little bit of a difficulty in the interpretation of the text, because the words believe can be taken as statements, or as questions, or as commands. And if you look at a whole bunch of different translations, English translations, you'll get different versions of this verse. So I'm understanding this just as the NIV has interpreted it. It's a statement at the beginning. You believe in God, Jesus is saying to the disciples. You believe in God. They were good Jewish people of the day. They believed in God. But in John's gospel, he's presenting that Jesus' words are from God, that Jesus is from God. So he says, you believe in God, believe. You believe, command. Believe in me also, because I've come from God. We're on the same page together. We're in this together. I have, in a sense, his backing. And Jesus' whole discussion with the religious leaders to this point was establishing that fact that Jesus' words were in fact God's words. So here's Jesus' point. Find hope through faith. Find hope through faith. We aren't able to control life. Have you noticed? If you have figured that out, please write a book and tell the rest of us how to do that, because we're lost in all of this. We can't control life. The troubles come, problems persist, disasters strike, and Jesus calls us to put our faith in him. We have faith, but it needs to be in him. He is greater than the difficulties of life. Isn't that exactly what the message was out of the story of Job? Where are you, God, in all of this? And God says, where were you? I am in control of all things. I made all these things. He can be trusted. So why is faith the best option to face distress? Jesus goes on to tell us that we need to trust him. Trust Jesus to keep his promises. Trust Jesus to keep his promises. He is faithful to his word. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, I would have told you that would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. Jesus is talking about the destiny or the destination of his followers, of those who trust him. Here's his promise to them. And this idea of in my Father's house, it's actually in a place of emphasis in the verse, in my Father's house are many, many rooms, talking about this unique relationship between the Father and the Son. And here's where it gets a little bit interesting. In the imagery of John's gospel, what exactly is Jesus referring to when he says, in my Father's house? How does John, the writer of the Gospel of John, used that phrase? And here's where it becomes a little bit of interest. It becomes a little bit interesting. And to keep your thinking caps on for just a moment. In John's Gospel, my Father's house, Jesus says that in John chapter 2 when he's clearing out these people who are selling stuff in the temple. And he says, don't turn my Father's house, which is supposed to be a place of prayer, don't turn my Father's house into a den of robbers. My Father's house, referring to the temple in Jerusalem. Okay? Got that? My Father's house, the temple in Jerusalem. Then later on in that chapter, the religious leaders were all bent out of shape because Jesus was messing up their money-making scheme. And Jesus says to them, and they say to him, what sign will you give us to show that you are authorized to do this kind of stuff, to say these kinds of things? And Jesus says, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will rebuild it. I'll build it back up again. They're going, wait a second, this temple took forever to build. You're going to destroy this physical temple, and you're going to rebuild it? It's taken 46 years plus, and they still weren't finished yet. But John, writing this gospel, says, what Jesus is referring to is his body that was going to be destroyed, and in 3 days in resurrection, it was going to be destroyed in death, but in 3 days later, it was going to be raised up. And that phrase, my Father's house, seems to be referring not just to the temple precincts physically, but John is using that to represent Jesus himself, his very body. My Father's house. There are many rooms, translated mansions because of Old English. It just means a permanent dwelling place, a permanent place to live. It's a place that is permanent. Jesus seems to be talking about the permanent relationship, the permanent bond between the person who believes in him and the Father and the Son. That there is a permanent relationship. When we trust Jesus, there is a new and special and permanent and everlasting relationship with him. He is God with us, come to be with us forever for those who trust him. Far more important than an imposing or grand manor house, a mansion that we're familiar with, but an actual relationship with Him. This is very much in keeping with what Paul talks about, a person who's a believer who is in Christ. They are in Christ, in relationship with Him. These many rooms, these dwelling places are Christ Himself, wherever He is, in heaven, on earth, wherever. And so He's referring not only future, even to ourselves, to when He returns, but He was also saying to His very disciples at that time, I'm going to leave you, but I'm going to come right back. You're going to see me again. And that's exactly what happened, that Jesus reappeared 3 days later, and they saw Him. And they were able to touch Him, and they were able to speak to Him, because He actually came back to them, to receive you to myself. In other words, what makes heaven heaven is Jesus. He's what makes heaven heaven. And that relationship that we have with Him is everything. Wherever we are as His followers, He is with us. And He said He will certainly bring us to be with Him forever. Jesus came from the Father's house, and He was about to return there. Therefore, He knew what He was talking about because He spoke from experience. You and I have had a beginning, but we'll never have an ending. We are eternal now. But Jesus never had a beginning and never have an ending. He came from the Father, and He went back there, and He's now preparing a place for us, going ahead to prepare a permanent home for us to be with Him forever. We can trust Jesus to keep His promises. He says He's preparing a place for us. What was Jesus when He was on earth? What was His occupation? He was a carpenter. He knows how to build. I wonder what He has for us in the future. He's had all this time to prepare. Lastly, what is the key then to facing life's distresses, having this knowledge? Then we need to get direction from an experienced guide. We need direction from an experienced guide. You know the way, Jesus said to the place where I am going. And Thomas said to Him, Lord, we don't know where You're going. How can we know the way? And Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through Me. If you really know Me, you will know My Father as well. From now on, you do know Him and have seen Him. Jesus' statement was, you know the way. You know the way. Three times the word way shows up in these seven verses. So that's the emphasis of the passage, the way, the way. He had taught them for 3 years about the way. Jesus' way was via the cross, right? He had to go through the cross to return to the Father. That was the way for Him. For us, for His disciples, and for us following Him, the way is through Jesus, who went through the cross. Father, He's opened up the way for us. And then Thomas asked the big question, and I am so glad he asked the question because it makes it clear for us, for the disciples too, because Thomas says, we don't know where You're going, so He's speaking for all of them. They must have nudged him and said, Thomas, you asked the obvious question because we're not sure what's going on. I'm glad he asked. He asked the question. And there's no doubt about Thomas's loyalty and love for Jesus. He was asking because he wanted to be clear, and Jesus answered. And He gives the sixth of seven I am statements in John's gospel. And the sense is here, I am the way, even the truth and the life. Or I am the way because I am the way. I am the truth and the life. Has that emphasis. And this is the whole reason why Jesus came to earth. It sums up His entire mission and ministry, that He came to be the way. The way. In fact, the early Christians were called followers of the way. It comes up a number of times in the book of Acts. It's not repeated anywhere else. But a number of times it talks about they were the followers of the way. The one way. The only way. And here's where we're faced with our problems as humans, as humanity. We have lost our way. That is the problem with the world. Pastor Bartley very quickly summarized the story of the Bible, God's story last week. Remember it? It was creation, fall, redemption, thank you, and restoration. Restoration. The fall. We have gone astray. We have lost our way. We are lost. That's why the world is the way it is. We have lost our way. Proverbs 14 tells us there is a way that appears to be right, but in the end it leads to death. That's where our world is going. It's going in the wrong way. We think we know the way. It might be through education, political solutions, scientific research, technological advancement, self-fulfillment. It all ends in death. We're lost. The way is not a philosophy. It's not a religion. The way is a person, Lord Jesus Christ himself. He is not one of many possible routes. He is the one and only way. And he's not saying that trying to exclude people. Sometimes we're accused as Christians that we're being exclusive and we're trying to exclude people and keep people away from the truth. No, it is the truth, and he wants to include people, but you have to follow the one way. There's not just many ways. You look at all the different religions in the world, they're all going in different directions. They all have different means of salvation. They all have different means of belief, different gods. Everything is going in different directions. There is only one route, only one way to the Father. And Jesus is pointing out that one direction. He is the truth, he goes on to say. I am the way, I am the truth, as opposed to the lies. Because our culture is telling us, we're not lost. We can find our way. We don't need God. We don't need somebody to tell us where to go. We can decide for ourselves. I'm the master of my fate. But this is false. When we're left to ourselves, what do? We destroy one another. That's the story of the human race. Leave us to ourselves and we will kill one another. Lord of the Flies, you ever read that book? Little boy stranded on an island, and what happens? That is the human race. Our world thinks there are many ways to God. This also is false. Jesus came to tell us the truth. Left to ourselves, we're on the road to destruction and death. Unless we do a U-turn. That's what the word repent means. It means just a U-turn. We're going the wrong direction, got to do a U-turn. Somebody once said, I want to change my life. I want to do a 360-degree turn in life. You're not changing anything. You're just going in the same direction. It's got to be a 180-degree turn to change your life. And that's what Jesus is calling us to. We need to trust him by following him. We show our trust by actually following him. His word tells us the truth about ourselves, that we're sinners. Not that we do every sin to the greatest extent, but our bent is towards self. Our bent is towards selfishness. Our bent is away from other people's and do what's best for me and not best for others. The Bible tells us the truth about the world, that it's fallen and broken. And the word also tells us how to find salvation. It's by God's grace through faith in Jesus. There's no other route. There's no other message other than that. That's everything that Renew holds onto and holds dear. It's by grace, God's grace. And lastly, Jesus said that he is the life as opposed to death. Jesus brought us life through death. That's how he accomplished life. The way was via the cross for him. And we're going to celebrate that and remember that in the next couple of weeks together as we go over the Easter season. Everything in the Christian life summarized by Christmas and Easter. Jesus came into the world to die on the cross for our sins and rise again. Everything is the whole story right there. Jesus brought us life. John's gospel, everlasting life is eternal. It lasts forever, but it's also a new kind of life as a full-time follower of Jesus. That's what it means to be a believer. It's not something we just do on Sundays between 10:30 and 12 o'clock. It's something that's a full-time thing that we do every day. We walk in relationship with him. Life of a full-time follower. However, to reject Jesus is to choose death. And this world with its pursuits and its monuments to human greatness it is all going to come to nothing. It will end at some point. Everything that we have, the technology and the monuments and trends and fashions, they're all temporal. But Jesus, what he calls us to, is eternal. Jesus wants us to experience real and lasting life. Get direction from an experienced guide. If you were out lost in the wilderness, this right after this one, can I just see the next picture? Oh, a couple more. There's a picture I want to show. There he is. If I'm out lost in these kinds of hills, I want a guy that looks like that. He looks experienced. He looks like he knows the direction. He knows how to get me through to safety. Listen, Jesus wants to bring home to his Father's house every one of us who are distressed out and distressed in life by this broken world. He is the experienced guide who's been there and back. He has prepared a permanent residence for us to be with him forever. And so we need to trust him to find the way home. And by the way, it is a good home because it is the Father's house. Some of us had wonderful homes that when we think of home, it's something happy and pleasant for us. Some of you may not have had a good home life growing up, or maybe even now it's difficult. But understand, this is the Father's house. It is a good home because a good God is over that home. We can trust and look forward to that. And Jesus promises infinitely better than any physical mansion. He promises a permanent relationship with himself. His presence is what will make heaven home. We want to go to heaven in order to see and be with Jesus. Pearly gates will be cool. Streets of gold will be awesome. I look forward to seeing some angels and some of the other saints up there. But the key is that Jesus will be there. He is what is going to make heaven home, the Father's house, because Jesus is going to be there. For to see and know Jesus is to see and know the Father. That's what he said in verse 7 so clearly. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. So follow Jesus to find home. Follow Jesus to find home.